Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. One message to Bria. So I'll run it from here. I usually run the, I forgot to tell you that. But I've got a little clicker that I do that with. Again, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Today we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit. And we've kind of been moving through these different doctrinal teachings that our church holds to, that the Christian church holds to. We went from God above all, kind of thinking about God the Father and the Trinity, to thinking about man. And then for the last 2 weeks, we thought about Jesus, what he's done and who he is. And this week, we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit. And before I begin, I just want to say that I hope that these little lessons that we're doing each Sunday don't just come off to you as abstract ideas. Okay, that's kind of a temptation sometimes of the Christian faith is to just have a bunch of ideas in your mind, to have a bunch of knowledge in your mind, but not to like believe in it, to not to hold it in your heart and hold it as a truth that is true in the world that you live in, and that affects the way that you see and experience and live out your life in the world, and especially with this one, as we talk about the Holy Spirit today. So I pray that you do that, that these teachings would take root not only in your mind but also in your heart. Both are very important, but some people will say that that's the biggest gap. Or that the gap between a believer and an unbeliever is about the distance from head to heart. And it's just a few inches, really. So I pray that you take these things into your heart. Okay. So we're talking about the Holy Spirit today, and very basically, okay, the Holy Spirit is the third member of the very mysterious person that we call the Trinity. Okay? This way that God has revealed himself in the scriptures, in three persons, yet one. God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and works through different purposes, for different reasons, through each one of them, but yet they are unified in one person, united in purpose, in their connection, and in their being, which is, again, incredibly mysterious to us, and incredibly hard for us to understand, and outright impossible for us to understand the nature of God. But as we look through the scriptures, we see these three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, all acting as God in harmony with one another, and the scriptures will testify that they are one, but yet in three persons. So that's why the Christian church believes in the Trinity, one God in three persons. And so the Holy Spirit is the third member. We have the Father, we have the Son, and we have the Holy Spirit. I just have this little verse up here from 2 Corinthians where it says, "Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom." And some people will call, this isn't on your outline, but I think that this is an important kind of feature of who the Holy Spirit is and how he works. Some people will call the Holy Spirit the kind of shy member of the Trinity. Like, we don't talk about him quite as much. We don't direct our prayers to him quite as much. We don't teach about him quite as much. It's even kind of harder to understand, like, well, what is he doing and where is he at? You know, we have a historical account of the person Jesus. We have a historical account of God the Father. Words from him, but the Holy Spirit is kind of this, a little bit more mysterious. So some people will call him the shy member of the Trinity. But I think a better word for the Holy Spirit is self-effacing. Now that is a weird word. Most of you guys, we're not using the word self-effacing very often, but it just basically means somebody, and you guys know people like this, somebody who never wants the attention himself or herself and points the direction to somebody else, so that whenever they're given, like, you know, praise or attention or whatever, they're always saying, no, it belongs to this person. Many of you guys do this when you'll do something really nice or really wonderful, and I'll say, that was great. And you'll say, it's all the work of the Lord, right? It's all glory be to God. That's a self-effacing move, okay? Now, there are self-effacing, some really good self-effacing examples, I think, in sports, actually. Sports is a place where you can often, like, get a lot of attention and draw a lot of, like, glory and praise from people. But there are some really, I think, neat examples of self-effacing types of people in sports. One of my favorite football players, two of my favorite football players, we're going to talk about football players, but two of my favorite football players, one of them is Barry Sanders. Any of you guys like Barry Sanders or Barry Sanders fans? Okay, so Barry Sanders is like a wonderful athlete, was outstanding running back. I mean, one of the best running backs in the last, you know, 30, 40 years. But he was not a flashy running back. He was just a shrimpy guy, ran real hard, was really great, and scored a lot of touchdowns. And whenever he would get into the end zone, you never saw him dancing, you never saw him spiking balls down, you never saw him like doing dances or these dumb little like things that football players do now when they score touchdowns. But you would always see him, as soon as he got to score a touchdown, he would run the ball over to the ref, hand it to him, and get back to the huddle as fast as he could. Never wanting to draw attention to himself because he knew that he was part of a team. Right, and that team was what helped him to score that touchdown. So it wasn't some show about Barry Sanders when he got into the end zone. Right? As a self-effacing guy. Another example of a self-effacing person is Tim Tebow. There's a lot of people that talk about Tim Tebow, a lot of examples of him. He's in the media a lot. But the guy is actually pretty cool. You know, and whenever he will be interviewed after games, and they'll have him comment good or bad about his play, and they'll say, "Oh, Tim, you had an amazing comeback in this game. You did a wonderful job. That was outstanding. How did you do it? What was your strategy? What did you do to be such a great player?" And his answer was always sort of the same, right? He would always start by saying, "But I just want to first acknowledge that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior in every single gift I have. You know, my legs, my throwing arm, my ability as a player is all His. Okay, and He gave that to me." That's how you pretty much start any press conference or interview. That's a self-effacing move. That's taking the glory and praise and then pointing it a different direction. Okay, so I believe that the Holy Spirit is like this. He is the member of the Trinity that desires the least attention, okay? Consider Jesus' words in John 15, okay? He says this. He says, "When the Advocate," which is the Spirit, "when He comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who gives out from the Father, He will testify about Me," right? And even in our John 16 reading, we heard a couple of times Jesus say, "The Spirit, He's not going to say anything that the Father and I do not tell Him to say," right? That the Spirit's job in the world is not to draw a bunch of attention to Himself, but to point people to Jesus. So sometimes people will say, like, "The Holy Spirit just isn't in this church. I don't see the Holy Spirit in this place." But I'm always a little bit hesitant about that, to be honest. If you hear Christ being preached, if you hear Jesus being sung about, if you hear Jesus being talked about and taught about, if you hear His cross being proclaimed, do you know who's behind that? The Spirit, who will testify about Jesus, right? He's self-effacing. His job in this world is to direct people's hearts to the One who saves them, to the One who came into the world and gave His life for all mankind on the cross. And so, I think that's just an important way to think about the Spirit in our lives, is as a sort of self-effacing. He works in our life to direct our hearts to Jesus. That doesn't mean that we don't know things about Him, but He does that. He directs our lives towards Jesus and proclaims His glories and His work. Anytime in the book of Acts, for example, you hear Christ, or you hear of the Holy Spirit coming, almost inevitably what follows after that is the preaching of Jesus. Preaching of Christ and His work, okay? So we do know some things about the Spirit, and we do see Him work throughout the Scriptures, and these are some of the primary ways that He works, okay? First, He calls people to faith. He calls people to faith, okay? 1 Corinthians says this. He says, "Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaks in the Spirit of God ever says Jesus is accursed, and no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit." So that when we like come to faith in our lives, oftentimes people will use the language of choosing God, which I'm honestly not that opposed to. I think that many times we make decisions to follow the Lord. We have in our mind, I'm going to commit this year or this time or my life to Jesus. That's a wonderful thing to do. But I would just say, again, you're talking about Jesus. You're speaking about him. Who's behind that work, right? The Holy Spirit who testifies to Christ, right? That he is the one who brings about faith in us. All of those little sparks that start the fire are the Holy Spirit inside of us, bringing about faith, bringing about trust, bringing about renewal in the Lord, okay? So that's the first way that he works, is calling people to faith. And to be honest, in evangelism, that always kind of takes the pressure off for me. When I know that I can share the word of the Lord with somebody and I am not responsible for their conversion, okay? That I don't have to have these clever arguments. It's good to know things about the Lord. It's good to be able to proclaim things about him and to argue for Christ. But ultimately, who changes the heart? It's not me, right? It's not me who changes somebody's heart to believe. It is the Spirit of God who brings out faith in people and kindles faith in us as well. So it's a good promise that we have from the Spirit. Also, he breathes new life into us. This is my kind of harmonica example. Through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. That this is the Spirit's work in us, is to breathe new life into us. The scriptures will talk about us as before we believed, before we were converted. It doesn't talk about us as sort of living. It doesn't talk about us as flickering flames, but it talks about us as dead. Right? Scriptures say, you, before you knew Christ, you were dead in your trespasses. But the Spirit breathes new life inside of us, right? That's, if you just imagine Genesis 1, where Adam and Eve are created, right? Adam is created from the dust of the ground, and God forms his body, and then what does he do? He's laying there as lifeless clay, and then how does he bring him to life? What does he do? He breathes life into him, and Adam comes to life. Well, that's the same way the Spirit works in us, who are now dead, lifeless clay, dead in our trespasses, is when we come to faith, when we come to new life and freedom in Christ, it is happening through the Spirit breathing new life in us. So he calls us to faith, he breathes new life into us, and then this is my favorite one. He brings us to repentance, okay? John 16:6, we just read this. Jesus says, and when he, the Spirit, when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. This, in my mind, is one of the most dominant ways that the Spirit is regularly working in our lives, is through the conviction of sin and repentance, okay? And we don't often attribute that to him. We sort of think like, we sort of attribute that to the conscience, like we have a heavy conscience, and so therefore we're going to repent of our sins. But if you look at John 16, I mean, that's the Spirit behind us, convicting us of sin. So I'll just say, you know, like as an example, if you are in the heat of a moment in an argument, right, and you walk away and you just said some real cruel words to somebody whom you love or somebody who you don't love, and you walk away, and have you ever felt the feeling where it's like almost immediately, maybe even before it comes out of your mouth, you just think like, I'm going to regret this. This is going to do some damage to somebody's heart. This is going to do some damage to somebody's life. And then you walk away, and there's that sort of heavy feeling like, man, I should turn around. I should go back and say, I'm sorry. I should go back and acknowledge that I did something wrong. You don't often attribute that to the Holy Spirit, but that's him via John 16:6. That is him speaking in our hearts and lives. So when you feel that, right, when you feel that sense like, I got to go back and make amends with my kids or with my wife or with my coworker or with that neighbor who is always letting their dog poop in my yard, you know, whatever, any of those things, right? Anytime, so when you feel that conviction, that's the Holy Spirit working in our lives to bring about repentance. Because why would God not want us to repent? That's his work, man, is for us to lay down our sins before him and trust in his work. So why would he not be a part of that work? And he is driving us every day to confess our sins, to lay them before him, and through his Holy Spirit to say, God, we're not right with you. We're not right with our neighbor. We're going to say we're sorry. And the Holy Spirit is saying, yes, that's me driving you to that. Okay? So he calls us to faith. He brings new life, breathes new life into us, and brings it to us to repentance. And then finally, he guides our life in faith and holiness. We just read Galatians 5, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. This idea that all these things, these characteristics that we can show in the world to both our friends and our enemies, that is the work of the Holy Spirit in us. And that's good. I mean, I would just say, like, as a parent, as a spouse, as a friend, if you want to encourage somebody, like, when they show these sorts of characteristics, to say to them, hey, I really see the Spirit of God working in you, son or daughter, or you know, my wife, I've just seen God working through you in the amount of patience that you show to your children. I'm just thinking of my wife now. But to your children or to your spouse or anything like that, that to encourage that in one another is a good and holy work. To say every once in a while, like, hey, I see you showing a lot of love to your sister or that classmate who's unkind to you. And I just want to affirm in you that is the Spirit of God working inside of you. That's a good thing to know every once in a while, because we can feel pretty lousy about ourselves. And I think to know that the Spirit of God is working inside of us, bringing about the fruit of holiness, the fruit of a faithful life, is a good and encouraging thing. And then I also like just at the end there, where Paul says, if we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with him. He gives us this list and then lays out this as a sort of, you know, as a goal for us. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I feel like you should be able to say those, just rip them off your tongue and say, like, that's the life that I want to live. That is the Spirit that I want to follow in. That's the Spirit that is inside of me that I want to keep step in all the days of my life. So those are some of the things that the Spirit does in us. He calls people to faith. He breathes new life into us. He brings us to repentance, and he guides in faith and holiness. Okay, that's also called sanctification. Now, I also just want to talk basically about three symbols or metaphors that are often used in the church, but then also in the scriptures to kind of describe the Spirit. And there are three of them. There are water and fire and wind. Okay, water, fire, and wind. We often see the sign of the Spirit connected to baptism in water. We think about the tongues of fire on top of the heads of the disciples at Pentecost. And that was a sign that the Holy Spirit had come to them. This kind of burning in our hearts and the burning in our minds to follow and do the Lord's will. It's the fire. And then wind is actually, in both the Old Testament and the New Testament, in Hebrew and in Greek, the word wind is also the words for spirit. Okay, so the word in Hebrew, it's ruach, and it means wind and spirit and breath. And in Greek, it's pneuma, which means wind and spirit and breath. And so the wind, this kind of mighty rushing wind coming down, that is a sign of the Spirit among us. But I just want to point out that each one of these symbols has a very negative connotation to it, actually, or can. Namely, I think because the Holy Spirit is actually kind of dangerous, if you think about it. So think about just water, all right? Water. I was looking last night at pictures of the flood here in 1964 and just how much that ripped apart the Flathead Valley. I was looking at the old steel bridge just crumbling underneath this flood that happened, this water that did great damage to farms and homes and towns. And some of you guys were here, remember that. You know, the damage that water can do to somebody's life, livelihood, neighborhood, to the world. We remember that the entire world was flooded by God to destroy everything, to destroy the sin that had kind of crept into everybody's heart. So water is dangerous, right? It's a kind of a negative thing, or it can be. Fire also Every year, I mean, the Flathead Valley is a good example of that too, that every year during the summer, you spend like a couple weeks hacking and coughing and rubbing your eyes because there are thousands and thousands of acres burning all around the Flathead Valley, right? We just see that happen over and over and over again. And fire can be incredibly powerful and incredibly destructive. And wind, I mean, y'all don't know really anything about wind in the Flathead Valley. If you want to know about wind, you got to come to Nebraska. That's where you got to come to. Okay, because Nebraska, it blows in your face at like 30 miles an hour kind of all the time. That's the standard nice breeze you get, okay? But then other times you'll see wind that's incredibly destructive. And not just tornadoes, but every once in a while you'll just get 90 to 110 mile an hour wind that just comes and decides to whip through the city and tear off everybody's roof, you know? But wind, it can be incredibly destructive, right? Well, the Holy Spirit, I think, in a similar way, can also be destructive in our lives. That anything that stands opposed to the will and desires of God, you know what the Holy Spirit's going to do about that in the world? He is going to seek to wreck that, to knock that down, and to make it no more, to make way for the kingdom, to make way for God and his Son to be believed in. Right? That's what the Holy Spirit, that's what the love of God in the Spirit is doing in the world. Right? I have I remember the sermon that this guy preached to us at the seminary one time, where he was talking about the love of God in the Spirit. And he said to us, he had this great line where he said, "Gentlemen, the love of God is not a warm fuzzy." That was his line. But he said that God's love comes and knocks things down. God's love comes and breaks down our hard hearts in order that the King of Glory might come in. That's the kind of love that God has for us. That's the kind of love that he brings into the world, is the kind of love that breaks down our hearts of stone and gives us new hearts in his Spirit. So wind and fire and water, those are often signs and symbols we see of the Spirit in the Christian church. Now, they also have positive overtones too, right? So water, nothing lives without water, right? Water washes us clean. Anything that ever grows or flourishes in our world or in our body comes from water, right? And if water is tainted, we're done for, right? So water is incredibly life-giving as well. And that's why we kind of have this double symbol in baptism where we say we are putting to death the old self and washing away and bringing about a new child through faith in baptism, okay? So we also have fire. Where would man possibly be without fire? We think about all of the even technological developments on a small level, right? Electricity and all these sorts of things work on like a spark that's kind of running across things, right? And fire gives us warmth, right? And gives us life and allows us to cook and do all sorts of things. And fire, I think, also in the scriptures you see giving life to people as well. And wind too. So all of these things are signs and symbols for us of the Holy Spirit and his work among us. And again, I just want to call you to not only have a knowledge of the Holy Spirit, but this is a person who the Word of God says lives inside of us. Jesus said that it would be better for him to go back up to heaven so that he could send us the Holy Spirit than for him to live on earth with us. Is that amazing? I mean, like that Jesus would say, it's actually better if I go, so that I can send the Holy Spirit to live in you and to direct your hearts and minds, your prayers, your confessions, your repentance, your faith, your good works. Like, that's not going to happen in you without the Holy Spirit. So I would call you not only to knowledge of the Holy Spirit, but to faith in him too. That you can pray to the Holy Spirit, you can believe that he works inside of you, and that he is directing your life and giving you faith and taking away your heart of stone and giving you a new heart of trust and love for God over and over and over and over again. The Spirit just promises to do that again and again and again for those who believe in him. Let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you and are so thankful that you and the Father have sent the Spirit into our lives. Would you direct our lives, our hearts, and our church to honor you and to love you and to lay down our sins before you through the work of the Holy Spirit in us. In your name we pray. Amen.